My talk, as mentioned, is going to be on the evolution of switching and routing data planes for next-gen carrier networks. And as we've heard this morning from all my fellow speakers, this vision of network transformation, it's really here. We've been talking about it for a long time. But the technology pieces are here. The energy, the motivation, the investment, they're lining up. And the vision for a highly performant, manageable, CapEx and OpEx efficient network with scalability and service agility, it's coming. But change is hard. And we have a lot of barriers to overcome still. Transformation is a work in progress, and there's a lot of devils in the details. So what is the scale of change we're talking about? What makes it so difficult? Let's look at it going from 4G to 5G. The scale of change, latency improvement of 50x is what's required. Throughput increase of 200 times. The connection density in the same geographic area of 100 times more. 7 times the data traffic aggregate over the same period of time. And a network infrastructure that's really truly transformed from dedicated closed hardware to programmable disaggregated elements that have to demonstrate the same level of reliability at much higher performance and much higher levels of agility. At the network level, we look at an existing carrier infrastructure ranging from radio and access side all the way through the aggregation and the core that's becoming fully virtualized and cloudified. But the scale of change here is also quite difficult, especially for incumbents. We talk about and look at the transformation of tens of thousands of connections to subscribers, all of which are increasing in bandwidth. The consolidation of thousands of central offices and the transformation of the underlying hardware and software that are in there. Several hundreds of mobile edge compute locations and a reimagination, rethinking of how that edge routing and aggregation architecture is actually implemented. The upshifting of the aggregate throughput of the aggregation and core network from 100 gig links to 400 gig coherent optical across the board. And on the network cloud side, the transformation using standard hardware and agile software components, but this common standard hardware has to serve many heterogeneous roles. We're talking about replacing tens of different previous legacy equipment with new software-defined infrastructure. So all of this is indeed a tall challenge for us. What is helping with this transition is the efficiency, performance, and universality of merchant silicon. Looking at what these types of equipment looked like just a few years ago, what merchant silicon, both on the CPU side and on the networking side, have enabled is the transformation of that to standard, high-volume elements of compute, storage, and networking with virtualization and the virtualization of appliances that can run and be provisioned, managed, orchestrated, on a one-touch basis. And the same applies to the network elements. So we look at standard high-volume Ethernet switches and routers that are connecting all of this equipment that are, again, orchestrated, automated, and configured with effectively very minimal human intervention. From the standpoint of merchant silicon architecture, how do we serve all these heterogeneous roles? Broadcom's approach has been that one size cannot fit all. When we look at the depth and breadth of these applications, you need to have the ability to address them across a span of attributes. We look at that problem as really segmenting into three different fields. And these are exemplified on this curve by the graph between bandwidth and service scale. the Tomahawk franchise within Broadcom is really integrating at a switching and routing level the highest scale-out fabrics that are needed to interconnect cloud elements. It boasts the highest performance and network radix that allow to get to the maximum bandwidth per unit of dollars and unit of watts. We also see that there's a need for a more robust and from a programmability point of view, as well as a feature point of view, for applications that need multi-protocol connectivity for the edges of the network, the cloud top of racks, or the DCIs, or the edges of the network. That feature programmable pipelines, tables, instrumentation, integrate large shared buffering elements, as well as large switching databases on chip. And then the third way of addressing the requirements in the carrier network is with extensible architectures, such as the Jericho and Qumran line, which basically enables customers to be able to integrate a multi-protocol programmable router on a single chip with software programmable elasticity in its pipeline, deep buffering with carrier-grade traffic management and virtual output queuing, and a scale-out cell-based fabric that delivers to the needs of carrier-grade networks. So these three architectures continue to be invested in and continue to deploy to be able to be the underpinning of these next-gen carrier networks at the connectivity side. What these architectures have enabled has been the transformation and of a legacy architecture, as well as ones that have been vertically integrated in certain spots, into a 5G network where everything can be actually automated, built on top of merchant silicon solutions. And this is important because basically, when you looked at the as I said, the variety of roles and the heterogeneity of the network, one size does not fit all. So the technology need is to be able to support the varied requirements, whether that's at the radio head end, at the customer premise, at the new next generation of the central office and access point, to the evolving edge, to the aggregation core, and then to the network cloud side. All of these have a need to have standard hardware, but need to have different architectural focus. As I said, the devil's in the details. So let me start by focusing on what's on the right-hand side with respect to the network cloud. So we can take some lessons from the hyperscale world. Not all lessons from the hyperscale world are lessons we should follow in this market, but there are some that are key here. When connecting the network cloud, there's been a lot of advances in the Ethernet connectivity side that teach us that the best way to connect large pools of compute and storage is to build out a highly robust, a highly scalable IP/ECMP fabric, and to do so by pushing and driving a lot of the programmable requirements to the SmartNIC. And this allows for the most robustness, agility in trying to drive the best economics out of the overall network. And in doing so, it optimizes for the maximum amount of bandwidth, the best TCO equation, and these are things that are supported by the math in terms of how networks are being built at this scale and deployed today. It can be designed for very high availability, robustness, fault tolerance, end-to-end network instrumentation, and it is built on a fundamental philosophy of disaggregation of components between the network hardware and the software. To build global and local leaf fabrics in the carrier network, we can leverage these same lessons. Broadcom solution in this space that enables the build-out of very robust and highly performant network clouds is our latest Tomahawk 3 family. Tomahawk 3 has been architected specifically for cloud scale applications with an industry leading 12.8 terabit per second of performance, up to 32 by 400 gigabit Ethernet ports on a single chip, enabling fixed platforms to be used and deployed in these types of networks at both the leaf and the spine. It allows for the scale out forwarding and load balancing between the elements, end-to-end instrumentation, and the reduction in power that's required in order to support the new next generation central office as well as network cloud requirements. So what's the impact of performance and radix? Well, as you can see here, it's really about TCO. It's about getting to more efficiency in the network. By just simply collapsing a two-tier network of 6.4 terabit switches into a single Tomahawk 3 12.8 terabit switch, an operator is able to reduce the cost of optical links by 50%, is able to actually reduce the hop latency, which is critical in these next-gen applications, by two-thirds, is able to reduce the system power footprint by combining six of these elements into one by over 80%. Those are significant TCO reductions which are leveraged by advancing on the latest technology from the interconnect point of view that connect up these elements. Now if we take a look at, for a second, a different part of the network, the cloudified and virtualized central office. The transition has been, first of all, from physical elements to virtualized elements, virtualized OLTs, virtualized border network gateways, all implemented through a leaf-spine interconnect. If we blow that up for a second and look at, let's say, a virtual BNG, there's really not just a simple switch at the heart of this. It's a multifaceted device, a different role, again, from what we saw in the network cloud. This requires an advanced policy layer. It requires intelligent subscriber termination services that enable protocols such as PPPoE, IPoE, SLAs that are held and enforced on a subscriber level. And then it actually collapses an entire edge router into its functionality for the upstream interface. So not just a standard top-of-rack switch. So those requirements give rise to a more varied, more involved feature set that's required in order to get to the best TCO for that socket. That means you need integrated carrier-grade packet processing and traffic management. That traffic management needs to be subscriber SLA enforceable, meaning you have the ability to schedule and shape down to a single one of those tens of thousands of users, and to be able to enforce and charge appropriately and monitor the data at that level. Highly concurrent packet processing from the router point of view, involving multi-protocol, a rich protocol suite, virtualization support, and of course, extremely high availability using traditional carrier metrics, whether it's, you know, protection switching, OAM, telemetry, and the like. This is a solution that is ideally served by the Jericho and Qumran architecture from Broadcom. Most notably, our recent Jericho 2 product serves this application as well as a wealth of other applications, whether it's edge routing, aggregation and P-core type of roles, scaling down all the way to the mobile edge and the X-Hall type of applications. This architecture lends itself to all of those because it features a highly scalable solution. It can go from a single chip in a pizza box all the way to a 200 terabit per second aggregation chassis. Looks like someone needs to press OK on that. It also features a software-defined elastic programmable pipeline, and that really enables the customers to be able to introduce new features at a significant pace and be able to operationalize new capabilities into the carrier network. It features robust deep buffering and quality traffic management, a QoS-based traffic management that is allows for subscriber-level or really broad subscriber-level traffic management and SLA enforcement. It also redefines the economics of these equipment, being able to do routers, switches, access equipment at extremely aggressive requirements for form factor, power, and economics. Is this me, or can I fix this? Okay, there you go. Thank you. Okay, and when we talk about programmability, I want to actually spend a word, maybe a couple of words about programmability. Programmability is definitely a requirement that is becoming more important going forward. We've listened to our customers, and when I said at the beginning, change is hard, change is also hard on the suppliers, too. We have to internalize and be able to drive our products and technologies to do better over time. Programmability as a concept needs to be qualified. There's no way to measure programmability without talking about concurrency and capacity. the requirements of the network that I showed before, especially on the NGCO side or on the core aggregation side, drives a lot of capability requirements out of the architectures. For example, in our Jericho 2 product line, the elastic pipeline enables programmability not just of small functions, but at the scale of being able to integrate over 90 lookup stages. When you look at the requirements when it goes across RSVP, layer 2 TP, PPP over Ethernet, multi-layer MPLS processing, all these things actually need to be integrated in the same equipment because a carrier deploys that in a bunch of different regions with a bunch of different subscriber counts with potentially different legacy requirements that are all being integrated into this new monolithic-looking access and edge infrastructure. So the capacity is important. What Jericho has with the elastic pipe is the ability to programmatically increase the number of stages by borrowing into an array of programmable elements in the pipeline and service those needs. So a network is truly future-proofed against against use cases and requirements for the future. And then concurrency. One needs to also be able to integrate this functionality in parallel all at the same time, and to be able to do that using the most efficient footprint as possible from an interconnect point of view. Jericho 2 has what we call a multifunction database, MDB, that enables massive centralized lookup capability into a common pool of resources on the switch chip that, again, can be very programmatically allocated and provisioned for the applications by the end user. And because of the flow is entirely software programmed, not just the ODM or the system integrator, but the actual end customer has the ability to press the button to be able to make these provisioning and allocation decisions. So programmability, an important concept, but must be qualified based on concurrency and capacity. And I'd like to end off by talking about the ecosystem. The advances and the innovation we've seen is not just about the silicon at the heart of this. It's certainly because of a healthy and highly progressing ecosystem around disaggregation. The hardware components, you know, strong players such as QCT that have enabled the deployment of disaggregated hardware that is coming out in record time after brand new breakthrough silicon hits the the docks. And then tack on that network operating systems that are being delivered independently to be able to provide agility to the end user. And then there's a whole host of application software on top of that and in the rack that's being done to be able to deliver the whole solution. One piece we need to work on is the optics, right? But there too, there are innovations happening that allow that that ecosystem to service better the needs of carriers going forward. So in summary, network transformation is hard. But standard solutions and merchant Ethernet solutions, Ethernet silicon solutions are helping to drive that change. Standard network elements definitely have to be heterogeneous in nature. That puts a lot of requirements based on varied roles in the network to be able to serve that functionality. And architecture matters. The choices shouldn't be based on buzzwords. They need to be based on detailed evaluation of the requirements and the capabilities of the technology at each node. And network disaggregation in the ecosystem is helping to accelerate the velocity of innovation at every point in the network. And so with that, I wanted to thank you again, Mike, and your team, for your partnership, the opportunity to speak today. And thank you again.